We are living in some crazy times. I signed on to TikTok this morning and I saw a girl eating her oatmeal for 2,000 people live. They're also telling me that this is a guitar. So this thing actually is a guitar. It's called a Strandberg. I've talked about them before on my show. To me, this is a guitar. It weighs about 37 pounds, it hurts my back, and my fingers hurt after playing for about an hour. I also used to walk 5 miles uphill in the snow both ways to school. You kind of can lean this any way you want. So like if I want to play straight up like Zakk Wylde, and it's not really straight up, or if I go like that, or even if I play like that. It started off with a guy named Ola Strandberg, who was at the time a software engineer for a biotech company. During the Christmas holiday of 2007, Ola had an idea to dust off the old hobby of building guitar after a 15-year hiatus. Apparently, Ola had been building guitars at one point. Through some coincidences, he stumbled on the community building the ergonomic guitar and quickly embarked on a journey to develop a new guitar that would not only be friendly to your body and sound great, but also be beautiful to look at. So the first step was to develop lightweight, high-performance hardware and parts in a modular fashion that can not only be used for these new guitars, but also to convert existing guitars to cut weight and improve playability, known as the ergonomic guitar system. If you notice this guitar, it has some pretty wild hardware, which you can imagine considering it doesn't even have a freaking head. This guitar is about 4 pounds. Coming from a software development background and recognizing the value of collaborative development and openness, Ola licensed the design under a Creative Commons license. This let others use the design freely under the assumption that they would be improved upon. The stipulation being that the original design had to be credited to him and the improvements had to be published under the same conditions and free for others to use. That didn't work out great because Ola had an unbelievable idea and people tried to take advantage of it, profiteer off of it, make copies of this before it even went fully to market. But no, Ola cut that stuff right out. But the idea that Ola was at least humble enough to know, I have a great idea, but the idea could be made better by others, that's his Creative Commons license. Unfortunately, people suck. How does a software engineer go and prototype this thing? Apparently he walked right on down to the head of mechanics at the biotech company he was working at. Hey man, don't worry, I'm not Ted Kaczynski. Can I borrow your lab for a little bit? I got some ideas. From those ideas, there was a local machine shop that actually started making early versions of this actual hardware, which looked very, very similar to what you find on Strandbergs today. One thing you're gonna find on all Strandberg guitars is the fact that they are multi-scale instruments, which the idea of a multi-scale instrument is really to have a longer scale towards the bass and a shorter scale towards the treble area to give you more trebly trebles and more bassy bass. But the real innovation for Ola was to have something that actually played easier. So if you're playing a 7 or an 8 string or maybe even a 9 string guitar because you're a psychopath, the idea that your high stuff is closer and your bass is further wasn't just about the sound, but just as much about the playability for the psychopaths that play guitars like that. Not me. I'm not that good, I can barely play 6 strings. People all over the world were building these headless guitars, which forced Ola to spend an incredible amount of his time continuing to develop and innovate the hardware. And eventually he got to a point where he said what Les Paul said ironically, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Just continue to tinker. By 2010, Ola decided, hey, I'm gonna build some more of these bad boys. I'm gonna bring them to the Fuzz Guitar Festival in Gothenburg and see what's up. It's one thing when you're showing just hardware. It's another thing when you show up with this thing. So because of that, Chris Leckford from Scale to Summit said, Ola, I want one. And that was the first guitar that Ola actually built for anybody other than just prototyping it. And that's kind of when the fire truly started. Now on this Bowden NX Trem, we gotta talk about the Trem. The EGS Pro Tremolo with its needle bearing post was developed to get around the issue of knife edge wear of conventional fulcrum tremolos. There are millions of gajillions of guys out there telling you that this is the greatest tremolo in the history of time. I don't know because I don't really bend. Well, hold on. Ooh, that's good. So by 2011, Tosin Abasi from Animals as Leaders and one of the greatest guitar players and a guy that's developed a bunch of his guitars on his own since then, he said, I need to know what's going on with this. And at the NAMM show, sat down and played one of these guitars and it was the greatest demo for Ola ever. You had people all over the internet going, what is that? Well, the answer is, first off, that's Tosin Abasi and he's not a what, he's a who. What he was playing was a Strandberg. And what he was doing with it was pretty incredible. People started thinking, maybe you don't need a head for a guitar anymore. And of course, when the Japanese market saw this, especially with the onset of all these 7 and 8 string players and all this new type of music that was coming out that was utilizing these instruments or these type of instruments. They said, we need that. Because of course, Japan, they know great ideas when they see them. This was a great idea. Let's be real. This is one of the coolest, most innovative designs out there. By September, when StrandbergGuitars.com was put up, Japan in particular was ordering the crap out of these things. Now, of course, this guitar was selling like nuts, but there wasn't really a name for this thing yet. And at the Uppsala Guitar Festival in 2011, one lady said, that looks like reindeer antlers. And in true, as they say on the website, IKEA fashion, they named this guitar the Boden, after a town in Gothenburg, Sweden, that raises reindeer. Why do they raise reindeer? Is it to eat reindeer? Is it for Santa purposes? You realize at this point, Ola is still going to work as a software engineer at a biotech company. All the while, he's sending stuff to Japan. He's innovating this guitar, going to guitar festivals. It's becoming a lot. And he's sort of realizing at this point, maybe he's got a real thing going with this Strandberg. Maybe this isn't just a hobby. Maybe this is actually something that Ola can put his name on this planet with. So by 2012, Strictly 7 Guitars approaches Ola and says, we should start making these things in Ohio. Of course, Ola obliges, they start making them, and they realize they're outgunned. They're not even able to make these things even close to as fast as they need to, so they move into the old Washburn Custom Shop in Chicago. At this point, Ola gets the idea for the flux capacitor, as far as I'm concerned, for guitars, the Endure Neck. That's kind of the real magic sauce for these guitars, which was inspired by the work of luthier Jerome Little, who had developed a twisted neck. Ola realized that the same ergonomic benefits could be obtained by shaping only the rear of the neck in a way that would guide the wrist into a better position. Combined with the trapezoidal shape that he'd already been using in collaboration with luthier Rick Toon, this promised to be revolutionary, and the patent application for the Endure Neck was filed in 2012. It's flat right here. So it's kind of like this triangular thing that you almost see this kind of neck on a lot of the 19th century parlors, but they don't have this flat piece. When I grab this guitar, it kind of forces me into this position, right? You see where my thumb is? This helps a lot of people, especially if you're learning, to develop a really good posture and technique, simply because of the way the neck is shaped. Up until this point, they've been doing 7s and 8s, but now they started kind of making guitars for dum-dums like me. I don't know what to do with a 7 or 8 string guitar other than take the 7th or 8th string off and then just tune everything else down. So of course, by 2014, Ola's at that point, you know, where they talk about it on Shark Tank. Do you jump into the pool head first and hope that there's water inside? Well, the truth is that there was 250 people on a waiting list for these guitars, and he's still going into work thinking, I'm gonna do something with this software thing. Except meanwhile, his phone's blowing up, his website's blowing up, people are asking him all the time, how do I get more of these guitars? Ola goes and makes this a full-time thing, which is an amazing story. Only 2 days into 2015, the custom shop from Washburn in Chicago sadly closed down. So only 156 Strandbergs were actually made. If you go and you find one from the Washburn shop, those are some of the most coveted Strandbergs to this day. So by 2016, things were really exploding. So by this point, they had to actually outsource some of their stuff to China because they simply couldn't keep up with demand. He made these guitars, he designed them, they started off on the blank page. He talked to a bunch of nerdy nerds online, came up with all this amazing hardware, went through prototype after prototype, went to different shows, had all kinds of guitar players all around the world give their feedback, came up with the Endure Neck, went from 2 different places in the United States, went to China. This guitar is actually made in Indonesia, and I believe their custom shop is now in Japan. And the thing is that you're seeing more and more kids walking around with this on their back saying, I love Meshuggah! Because, well, 7, 8, 9 string music is becoming more popular, and there's no question, because the market has spoken. These things are designed to the freaking nines. So today, my buddy Matt LaPierre, who's a good friend of mine, one of the most amazing guitarists that I freaking have ever encountered, brought me 3 of his Strandbergs. And I said, you know what? Let's make an episode where people can watch, they can understand the history, but they can also listen to a competent player like Matt actually demo them. I have my friend Matt LaPierre, way above my pay grade as far as his ability to play, and he's gonna demo these guitars because, well, they're his. Will you be kind enough?
So this is the Boden NX6 in Autumn Burst with the Sur pickups, 5-way selector switch, just a tone and volume. Running through the Fractal XOFF 2, and we're going through a cab. Sounds like this. Just playing leads on this. This is effortless.
figure out something. How about a jar of weed?
That works.
Here you go.
So just to go through the positions here, you have the first, which is just your bridge. You know, it's your classic. Then you have it split. This one, position four, which is probably one of my favorites. It's got that kind of split. It's that just very buttery, almost stratty.
It sounds like you should be playing Lights by Journey.
Yeah. It's got that tone without getting sued for copyright infringement.
No, you can play it. Play
oh,
it.
Again?
Yeah, absolutely. Play it.
Position, which is again, you get the blues tone. Position four. Middle, you get that classic. Got a lot of spank to it, which is great. I believe this is the inner and outer coils here on the both positions, so you're getting a little bit of that cut too. And then your classic bridge, which is a little more of that. This guy right here is the fret wrap from Groove Gear. Basically helps me cheat a little bit. This is the Bowden Original 7. These were roughly produced, I believe, 2018 with the roasted maple necks. I believe this is a 5-piece too, as you can see on the back. Same crazy neck carve. I don't know if that's picking up as well on the camera. There we go. Super comfortable. This was actually my first Strandberg I got, as you can maybe see with some of the shine marks from playing so much. They're all satin finishes. So this was, until you look at, you know, the corners and the pickups and everything. But overall, such a well-rounded instrument for being a, you would predominantly see these in the metal scene. I've used these for country sessions. I've used it in so many different applications, hip-hop tracks. Everything just comes through and it cuts. It's got a modern tone. Still feels like home when you play it. Chug though.
What do you feel? How do you feel about that multi-scale for this guitar?
The only time I ever find it to be an issue is when I wouldn't even say an issue, it's something you adapt to. But essentially it's those big stretches up here just because it's a wider fan.
So do you think it makes it easier to play with the multi-scale? How do you feel about it as a whole?
I only noticed it when I first got this guitar, and now every time I pick it up, it feels natural. It's one of those things where I don't even realize that it's... A lot of times, even if you're sitting with a 7-string for the first time, and you're gonna play some, you know, something that you would normally play in standard, even your... And then even with the... You don't notice it at all. It's fantastic. Pickup 2 on these is phenomenal. Even if I were to kind of pull a little bit back, you can even still get that.
That's something you definitely don't get on the
not on an active pickup.
So I want to say thanks to my buddy Matt. If you haven't checked him out, in my band, Lost Symphony, in particular, our most listened to song on Spotify, Conflagration, that insane, insane playing when it first comes in, like absolutely mind-numbing. That's Matt LaPierre. Go check out Matt's new single, Restless. He's known as Matthew LaPierre, his full name, on Spotify. And I want to say thanks for letting me mess around with your Strandbergs. And clearly, just like the girls eating oatmeal live on TikTok, the Strandberg is here to stay. Why don't you smash that subscribe button already?